All right. Well, it's 11:01 on my watch, so we can get rolling. Hello and welcome, everybody. I'm really, really excited to be here with you today at sunny Florida, even though I'm reporting from sunny London, Ontario, Canada, with 2 meters of snow outside of my window. So today we will be talking about the anatomy of Git workflows and essential commands you must memorize. It's kind of like mostly, something that we don't typically do in terms of when we're looking at the Git tutorials. It's actually more advanced day-to-day operations that we always Google, I at least Google often, and that save your life. It's when you get into the situations when it's very complicated. You don't know how to resolve the problem when Git is unhappy with you. So we will be covering those cases today in a little bit more in depth, but we also will be covering some workflows that could make a life of your team easier. So without further ado, let's get started. If I can move in. Okay, here we go. So a little bit about myself. My name is Anna Mikhailova, and I'm a senior architect at Kalamuna. We are a friendly bunch of people who are fully distributed team between Canada and US, and we have two offices in Auckland and in Toronto. So by our website and check us out. I'm a Drupal 7 and 8 Acquia certified grandmaster. I am nature enthusiast, so if I'm not coding and resolving Git problems, I am outside playing with my dog and taking pictures of flowers and plants and enjoying the weather when it is a good weather. So that's a little bit about myself. If you want to connect with me after the presentation, please feel free to ping me on Twitter. I'm most active on that social network. So tweet at me and I will be able to help if you have any questions or need some help or whatever that may be. All right. Okay, so a little bit about Kalamuna. As I said, we are full service web agency. We do design strategy, we do UX, we do development and Drupal, WordPress, and other platforms. So we are there to move your mission forward and help you out with all of your web needs. We're currently hiring for a few positions, so if you're in hunt for the job, hit our website. We are looking for the front end lead, for the back end developers and WordPress developers. So ping us if you're interested in something and you're searching for a job. All right, so what we will cover today, we will cover types of Git workflows that are typical for the team collaboration. I'm sure there are more than the ones that we will be covering. I'm covering the major ones that are vastly adopted throughout the community and different teams. When to use each of these workflows and the useful commands to solve the problems that you might have while working with Git, especially if you're new to Git. All right, Git workflows. We've got some issues. Let's dive into them. So workflows, centralized feature branch and Git flow and forking. So there are four major workflows that people are starting to use. And technically the team starts with, typically starts with centralized if they are new to the Git, and then they progress through the feature branch. Sometimes they go into Git flow and sometimes they're using forking. And we'll cover when to use which one of them or when it is the best fit for your team in details in a second. All right, let's start with centralized. So what does that mean, centralized? Well, if you come in from the world of software development, like an old school pre-Git software development like SVN, you know that there was one central repository and everything was pushed into that repository and this is how it worked. Git kind of pushed it a little bit further because even with centralized workflow, every person has technically two repositories. One is their local where they can stage commits, make changes, branch out. And then when they're ready, they push a branch and push their commits to the remote repository. That remote repository, for example, your GitHub or Bitbucket or GitLab, is actually a source of truth. And that source of truth is being pulled into other developers' local versions. And this is where the with. Technically, people have just one main or master branch. Right now, we kind of have a trend to rename masters into main, so I'll be using these terms interchangeably through the presentation. But basically, this one branch is the main source of truth where you have all of the commands, and that is going to your production environment eventually. And developers can branch out on their local, but typically they don't deploy branches to the repositories. They may have local branches and merge locally to masters, push their commits, and that's it. So there is no defined pull request in this workflow or forking patterns. Typically just everybody push to master, clone or pull out from master, and continue working this way. What's the advantages of this workflow? Well, it is easy to adopt and learn. Basically, all you need to get going with it is a clone repository and start committing things to it and learn a little bit how to deal with merge conflicts. It's very easy, and a lot of teams start this way when they're starting to adopt Git, or if you're new to Git and you're trying to learn it on your own, that's pretty much where you would want to start. So it is also ideal for small teams of 2 to 3 people. Because if you have more than that, then, other workflows may be a little bit too complicated, and merge requests, especially if you working, let's say, on 2 different disciplines. So for example, you're a backend developer and you're working with the front end, and that's your team, 2 people. Then having a merge request, for example, your front end is creating a merge request for you to review the CSS. That might be not your area of expertise, so that creates a bottleneck, and you not necessarily can provide a peer review, right? For that, if it's not your area of expertise. So for small team of people where you have very distinct roles, that centralized workflow could be a great start. The downside of it, if you have a bigger team with multi-disciplined people who actually have, you have multiple backend developers, you have multiple front-end developers, or you have a few full stacks, or you have, technical lead or an architect who can review everything as well on the team, then this workflow suffers because they don't have a defined peer review workflow. And that's a problem because technically the quality of the code can suffer if we don't review each other's codes and don't benefit from, this extra pair of eyes. Another problem is this workflow, because we're pushing just into one branch, there is no ability to deploy just this feature. We're deploying everything, just basically like a waterfall or avalanche of changes. It goes into dev and then to testing and into production. And when client comes in and say, oh yeah, in out of these 3 features, events feature and then news feature and maybe alerts feature. We really like alerts, but news and events, so they need to be changed to have some revisions. You can't really say, okay, well, we'll just deploy alerts. You'll have to wait and complete all of the revisions for news and events as well, and then push everything into master. So that's a downside too, because, changes cannot be deployed progressively. You'll have to, plan for deployments and make sure that this release cycle is small enough to accommodate all of the revisions and deployments, so you don't create this huge stop gap, basically, because you are trying to refine 1 or 2 features. So that's a downside of the centralized workflow. The next workflow is feature branching. It's a direct evolution out of your centralized workflow, and that came out of a pain point of I cannot deploy a feature, hence the name of feature branches. So every feature, so your architect or technical lead, or you yourself as a lead developer or as a single developer on the project, if that might be the case, you break down the requirements into features. So for example, search would be a feature, your news content type will be a feature, in events will be a feature. You break it down into these tasks, and then every task gets assigned a branch, and you can name it against, if you're using Jira, against the Jira code. That's a popular way to name things. Another option would be, having the ability to name it under the feature and then like actual name of the feature. So for example, feature/news or feature/article or things like that. And in this way, all the functionality related to this feature goes to this dedicated branch. So you are isolated from your main branch or your master branch, and you are working on that feature only. And then after you're done working on this feature, you think it's in a solid place on your local, you keep committing into the branch and remote repository, so your code is safe and stored somewhere outside of your local machine. But then when you're ready, you create a pull request, and that pull request is being assigned to your teammate for review, and they review it. You know, you can even stage, especially if you're using hostings that allow multi-dev environments, and something like Pantheon, for example, allows multi-dev environment where you can stage a particular branch. But even like other hostings too, Acve allows to switch the code into the different branch. You can also use other solutions like Tugboat to stage certain things. And if you do that, you can stage that feature, show it to the client. Client can come up with revisions, and you can deploy these revisions into this feature branch and keep refining it. And when it's ready and it's passed the pull review, it's actually goes into the master branch or main branch and be merged into it. And this is where it becomes a released code. And then it's where it goes into your dev and QA and production environment eventually. So lots of benefits out of this workflow. It helps to organize your code base based on the feature. So that means that technically you could revert that merge commit later on if something went wrong, and you're not really have to handle, 20, 50 commits that would belong to this feature. They're all together into this merge. It promotes collaboration within the teams. It means that we all are benefiting from the opinion from other people, which is fantastic because we all need a second pair of eyes to feel, more confident in ourselves and the work we produce. And that means that main branch hopefully should never contain broken code. That means because we already reviewed it, we already staged it, the clients saw it. So everything is great and we are confident in our code. So when we merge, hopefully no broken code or, untested code goes into the main branch, into the release. On cons side, PRs can be overhead for the small team. As I mentioned on the centralized workflow, if you have only two people on the team and you have vastly different, responsibilities, then there is no point to have this because you will create PRs to yourself. You may still have feature branches occasionally. So if you know that you're building something huge, like a big functionality that needs to be pre-staged for the client, you can then still make a branch for yourself and show it to the client, but you won't be doing it consistently because, for changes of, let's say, padding on the title, you probably wouldn't make a peer, pull requests to yourself and then merge it. It's just an overhead. This workflow proves to be harder to learn and adopt, especially for people who are new to Git, because working with branches can be a pain. It is something that needs to be taught, needs to be learned, all the commands, all of the management features, and how to effectively rebase, how to effectively resolve conflicts. So some people find it's more challenging than a centralized workflow. You have to wait to merge for dependent features. So for example, a good example would be if you didn't use an atomic feature branch, but you actually have a feature branch for, backend development, and the front end is a different one. You cannot merge the front end into the release or into main branch until your backend is fully refined. So you'll have to wait for dependent features to merge. Otherwise you may, produce a lot of merge conflicts and problems, and that's not what a lot of people want. So that's a cons of this workflow. Git flow. So a lot of people started working on a bigger teams, especially big agencies that have strict protocols and continuous release cycles. They thought that they can't really finish things up quite a bit in terms of, you know, just feature branches, especially if they have huge teams, like, you know, teams of 20 people working on the same product. So those are mostly like product-driven agencies that are using this, or big applications, sometimes huge websites, like government websites, huge financial websites. But in general, there are a lot of use cases for that. When it's the team is particularly big and the processes of releasing certain things are critical, this is basically when you will adopt the Git flow. And Git flow even has its own extension, so you don't have to run raw Git commands. So if you install a Git flow extension, it will make your life easier and you can use those commands instead. But the idea behind it is that it defines a very strict branching model. So your master or main branch is the one that contains tags. And if you worked ever with Pantheon or Acquia, you will notice that what's deployed on their upper level environments is actually a tag, and it's not really visible out of you know, out of the blue if you don't look under the hood. But what's happening is they create a tag or snapshot out of your main branch or master branch, and they deployed this tag or artifact into test and production. This is a very safe way of doing it because tags cannot be changed. So you cannot commit into the tag. It's not a branch. So this on my picture on the right, you see version 1.0.1.0.2 and so on and so forth. These actually are tags, so versions. And then the next step of this Git flow workflow, there will be a develop branch. So develop branch is acting as an integration branch. If you think back into our centralized workflow, that's a branch where you have everything merged into. So what happens here is if it wasn't centralized workflow, this is our main branch, but in the Git flow workflow, it is a develop. So all the feature branches that are green in our illustration, those feature branches are going to be merged into develop branch. So they're based off develop branch and they merge into the develop branch. So developer will basically create a branch based off the develop, and they will name it as a feature branch, make all of the commits, and when the pull request is reviewed, this is merged back into develop. And when we are ready for release, this is when we will create a tag and basically merge it into the master. You can also have a hotfix branches, and a hotfix branches, those are the branches that are pulled out of master, and you just quickly create a hotfixes. This is what Pantheon does if you need to deploy something quickly on production just to fix it quickly, like you find a bug. This is what you will do. You will deploy a hotfix there. So that's similar to the Git flow hotfix branch in here. And then basically master will just have this release snapshots all over it. The advantage of this one, it sets specific purposes for every branch, so it's easy to learn, but it creates some overhead for the teams because it's a lot of, you know, protocols to follow. So it's well suited for big projects and teams, great for projects with defined release cycle. So by that I mean it's something, you know, like Drupal, for example, or any other big open source software that has this release cycle can use Git flow to make sure that everybody knows what's going into which branch, and we are ready for release and we don't step on each other's toes committing the code. And it also allows multiple teams to work on different releases. So for example, you have one team that is working on features A, B, C, and another team that works on features, you know, D and E. So all of these teams can actually start on a different release. So A, B, C features will go into release one, and D and E features will go into release two. So while first team is preparing release one, the second team can work on release 2 without actually affecting, you know, first team. So we will keep the maintenance of continuous releases. And if I give you a real life example, you know that we have Drupal 9 and the work is going into Drupal 9 still and we're releasing new versions, but Drupal 10 is already in development. That's exactly what happened when Drupal 8 was released, Drupal 9 work started. So that's kind of gives you an example of how that may work. But if it's a small team, again, that's too much of the protocol or procedures that need to be following to complete a small project. Or when you are only one developer, obviously you don't want to have 20 branches that you need to, you know, orchestrate together to get the results. And it has a steep learning curve because you need to not only provide documentation for your team of how you name everything and naming convention and your missions management, but you also need to explain people how to actually interact with these branches in effective manner so that doesn't slow them down. And the last workflow that we will cover today is forking. So what forking workflow does is actually really great for open source projects. And it was created when we realized that we would like to collaborate with people that might not be inside our organization. So let's say we release an open source project, maybe a library or, you know, module or any other package. And I want to, as a maintainer, to maintain quality and consistency of my code, while I still want to open it up for other people to contribute. And I don't know these people. I may or may not see them. I may or may know their skills and their intentions either. So what the forking workflow allows you to do is allow people to fork or create a clone copy out of your repository and work on it. And they can do branches, they can do anything they want. And then when they're happy, they can actually do a pull request from their fork into your main repository. And you as maintainer is the only person, a group of maintainers from your organization are the only people who are able to merge that pull request out of the fork into the main repository. That reduces the risk for collaboration. So the advantages is allows multiple third parties and contractors work together and still get access to the code base without the necessity of, you know, sharing too many rights and risking the ability for them to break something for you. So that's typically seen in the big open source software projects. And cones, well, it's not really cones, but it's like, if you are in the same organization, you probably wouldn't make everybody out of your developers to fork the repository because you should be able to collaborate in a normal way with other workflows. So forking might provide some sort of feeling of, you know, not trusting each other as much. But basically, that seems like too much of an overhead. Obviously, there could be cases where that works for your organization and it's totally fine, but it's not a typical workflow for internal team, at least in what I've seen throughout the companies I talk to. All right, so that's our workflows. Let's jump into the Git commands. So there are a bunch of Git commands. I think you all should know by now the Git commit, Git push commands. So we'll be diving into a little bit more advanced stuff. Right, and I'll start with my favorite one. I think everybody knows this, but it's very useful. It's Git diff. It gives you the difference. It has a couple options too. So if you ever wonder, it's like, oh, I stage it. So a typical workflow I sometimes have is, for example, I export Drupal configuration, let's say I enable the module, and I said, oh yeah, I want this core extensions YAML file into it, and I put it into stage, and I suddenly don't see, I don't remember, oh my God, did I actually committed something that I also enabled, let's say I enabled the Vel module and didn't intend to commit this configuration change, and I can't see it anymore because I already staged it. So if you go git diff -- staged, that will allow you to see the difference between the changes that you're just about to commit and the original ones. Git diff one branch to another branch can show you the PR basically. So if you don't want to use a interface, so you don't have the ability to use the interface to see the pull request changes or the difference between branches, you can use this command to see the pull request in your command line. And that's very useful if you're trying to quickly review something and you don't have access to your GitHub or Bitbucket, GitLab, or whatever GUI environment you might have for the Git stuff. The next one is partial commit. This is great, and I'm really sad that not all the Drupal developers know it or use it on a daily basis. I use it on a daily basis. Specifically, it needs to be used with the flag. So you can do git add interactive. So it gives you a lot of options for the interactive addition to your commit, or you can use the short form as git add dash I. I recommend to just go with git add-p because I find that this is the most useful option. And the reason why this is the most useful option, it allows you to select just chunks of commit for the file. Again, that is mostly useful for the configuration management. So a good example would be you updated certain things in the search index, and it was obviously a local search index, and all you want to commit is these different fields that you added, but you don't really want to overwrite what server it belongs to. Is it read-only? Is it, index immediately? And you might have switched these options on just for ease of debugging on your local or development. So git add-p will allow you to choose just the changes that you want to commit and, omit the rest. Very useful. If you use it, you save the life and, struggles for all people who review and work with you on the changes. I do recommend to incorporate it in your workflow and make everybody's life easier. And then when you do git add-p, it actually gives you the, kind of a list, and you can take a look and see what's going on and which changes to use and include. The history. Git log, I think everybody knows this command, but git log dash dash follow file is very useful if you want to see a history for just this file. It's like, I don't understand when this file changed, or I didn't change it, maybe I did. Git follow file gives you the full history of this file, with commits and when they were made and everything. So that's very useful for debugging. The other one is git show commit hash. So this commit messages that GitHub shows to you, or Bitbucket shows to you, or the commit hash, or git log as well. If you do git show commit, you can see what exactly was committed. Specifically, if you are trying to figure out if you committed something more than you wanted to, and trying to debug, trying to revert certain things, git show commit hash, that is what you will see where all your changes were made. And it's great, like Pantheon shows a little bit of it on every new commit, but this one definitely shows you a little bit more. So that's good. Git blame, our favorite one. I think every single Acquia exam that I had similar questions about git commands, and git blame was probably one of them. Git blame allows you to see who to blame for the things that broke. And basically, it shows you who worked on the files and what was changed. And then git blame file dash L actually shows you the log. So actually shows you the time and the name of a person who worked on it. And you can see whom to blame, which teammate to come to and say, you broke my stuff. Or maybe it was you, and you will say, oh my God, I am so mad at myself now. So that's another one. Remove tracked files. So right here is, it's a very popular one. And that typically happens if a new developer who is not very familiar with Drupal sometimes does it. And often I make this mistake too. So you set up your new vanilla Drupal installation or your base installation, whatever it might be, and you just committed settings local PHP. That's a typical use case for that. And sometimes you commit something that you didn't mean to, like you set up a new SIM and accidentally notice that node modules were not excluded. Git ignore wasn't to your liking and you just didn't check it because this happens. We are all rushed and have different priorities. So that's what will help you to get out of the situation. So the first command, git rm dash r cached file, will allow you to erase git memory about this file. then delete the file, and then you update your gitignore and commit the gitignore fix changes, and you're done. The file is not tracked by Git anymore, and you're happy to continue with your life. Yeah, if you want to keep it in your local, you don't have to delete the file. So that's optional. You just need to tell Git to stop thinking about the file. So that's very good and saves my life quite a bit. Remove files from PR. That's a tricky one. I don't know if it happened to you ever. It happened to me a lot. I commit something into PR and I think everything is clean and good. And then I go to GitHub, look at my PR and like, oh, that file, I didn't mean it there and it's there. And you don't like, the first instinct would be like, I delete it, but that's not what you want. You don't want to commit deletion of a file. You just need to remove it from PR because it's not atomic and it's from a different feature and you just committed you didn't see. It's very easy to do. You need to check out the PR branch, so the branch that you just committed the files to. Reset the file against your main branch or whatever you are trying to pull request against. So if it's not a main branch, if it's a release branch, you will use git reset origin release or whatever your repository is called and include the file in there, then commit it, and then check out and dash dash everything. It just checks out this new changes and git push, and that's it. Your file will be removed from the PR. That's great, and it will help your reviewers to make sure that, you know, your PR is atomic and you didn't commit something that shouldn't belong there. A little trick helps everything and makes everybody happy and your managers happy too. So that. Assume on-site changes. Very great if you do security core updates and you're using some sort of a distribution. So something like, for example, Panoply, or you know you're using Pantheon upstream, or you're using any other upstream, and you know that those changes should be assumed. So you can actually do git checkout theirs, or and that will basically assume their changes overused because hopefully you're not hacking core and your changes don't matter. You can also do git checkout ours. Definitely don't do it if you do security updates. But if you, for example, know that the changes you are pulling yours are superior, you can do git checkout ours. But also git checkout theirs is the most popular use case of that. So. Create patches. That's another great one. We will be having a contribution workshop, and I'm sure you will be using that quite a bit, creating patches against certain branches and in Drupal project, like for Drupal modules or core, wherever you are. That's a great comment. It helps you to create a patch and then commit it into Drupal org. So git diff with no prefix and dash u creates a very good patch, and it outputs it into file. So replace the name file with whatever name of your patch should be, and you will be good to go. Clean the folder. Another one is if you use Compose install, Compose update, and you're not tracking contributed modules, which you shouldn't. If you can, you should probably use continuous integration to install your contributed modules or install it with Compose right on your hosting, for hosting that support Compose workflow. Then you sometimes may end up with untracked directories, and then you try to rebase or pull a different branch and start telling you you haven't tracked files that will be overwritten. So what do you do? You don't really need these files to be tracked. You just need to get rid of them. And I saw a lot of junior developers sometimes go in and just start manually deleting them. And it's very difficult. It's, you know, it's an annoying process. Let's not do that. All you need to do is do git clean -fd, which is cleaning files and directories. And it removes all the untracked things that you don't want to track. Just make sure you, before you run that, you track everything you actually want to keep. So like if you wrote a new custom module, please commit it before you do git clean files directory. It's not reversible, it will delete it and you may get upset. So yeah, commit everything before you run this command, but helps to clean. And then push with upstream. Another very omitted flag, it's good if you do rebase instead of merging, because you don't create the spaghetti log. You actually do the full legitimate rebase. And in order to do it, you need to track upstream. And to track upstream, you need to push with dash u. So when you create a new branch, you push with dash u, and that will make sure that it understands the upstream concept. And then next time you pull out of this branch, somebody else push into it, you can do git pull rebase. It's very good, very useful. A lot of people just do git push origin and the branch, and that's not going to produce the same results as adding this dash u flag. So do recommend that. All right, that's a very scary one, but let's say you started setting up your new website and you push a lot of things and you figure it out that you push a lot of commits because certain things were not working. Typical real life scenario would be you pushed something into your website and your CI wasn't working and you committed 20 times to make sure that CI finally works. And hooray, CI works. Do you really want to maintain 20 commits about how fixing the typo, testing CI again, testing CI one more time, final. All of that, you probably don't. You want a clean commit log. So because you do, sometimes it's great to run those commands. I'm not going to read all of them, but basically what they do, these comments in here, they make sure that your most current commit becomes the initial one and cleans up all of this, you know, initial setup. I don't recommend doing it in the middle of your project, but if you are the one who is setting up a new site and you run into the CI hiccups or any other, you know, hosting hiccups, and you go to all of this, I'm so frustrated testing commits just to make sure it works, and you now want a clean slate and clean start, that's how you do it. You can run those commands and that will make your most recent commit that is working an initial one, and your team can start from the fresh start. And that's all commands that I had to share with you today. I have a couple announcements. Please follow our code of conduct. If you have questions, please follow the links below to learn more about them, or reach out to Amy, June, or Mike if you have any questions or comments about the code of conduct. And then we will have a contribution date, and there will be first time contributing workshop, mentoring contribution, and general contributions. Please attend, it's very fun. It's a great way to learn and to join the community. And there are some planned workshops and initiatives that you can join and contribute and, you know, be part of the community, because we all come for the code and stay for community. And with that, thank you very much. If you want to connect with me, please reach our website on me on Twitter. And it's time to open for questions. Any questions, please post in the chat. No? I don't see any questions. Well, if no questions, then please take advantage of the slides. If you suddenly don't have access, just ping me and I will give you an access to the slides. Thank you so much for joining. It was very exciting, and feel free to find me on Twitter or Drupal Slack or anywhere you want, and I will be always happy to help. Yeah, I'm not going to close the room, but I will stop sharing. You're welcome to hang out here as you like. Thanks.